For me, there's something absolutely magical about the old F1 engines, the V10s and V12s in particular, screaming to thousands of RPM that we just don't have these days. However, it's not that usual for a company to decide to go and build their own bespoke V10, but that's exactly what Rodin Cars from New Zealand have done. We're here with Mike from Rodin Cars to find out a little bit about the background of their RC.TEN bespoke V10 racing engine. Now, Mike, for a start, when you're in the market for a V10 engine, there are already manufacturers of these engines, and Judd pop into mind. What was it that made Rodin decide to essentially reinvent the wheel and build their own?
So our founder, David Dicker, really likes to keep a handle on everything. And if you're relying on an external customer to provide you with goods, there's certain things that you can't control. And there have been issues in the past with our company dealing with other companies sort of not being able to come to the park with those sort of things. So David's like, all right, we're going to do everything in-house, like nuts, bolts, everything. We've got a foundry. Yeah.
And that on face value to me sounds like an absolutely massive undertaking for particularly in New Zealand. We're a small country, not particularly well resourced. So what was the requirement in terms of bringing on more engineering and more abilities into Rodin Cars to take on such a massive project?
So we actually worked with a company in the UK called Neil Brown Engineering. So it was a collaborative design with our founder, David, and them on all the engine specs and that sort of thing. And then they actually outsourced a lot of things to the likes of Pangle, who really, really know what they're doing to design the pistons, the crankshaft, and the conrods and that sort of stuff.
For people who haven't heard the name Pangle before, this is really synonymous with most of the F1 engines. They're making internal components for that level of engine already.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay, so can you tell us a little bit more for those who haven't heard the name before, Neil Brown Engineering? Where do they come from and what is their sort of domain expertise in this area?
I believe the main guy there is an ex-Cosworth engineer, and he sort of left that and then went to work for them and is in charge of the engine design sort of thing. Yeah.
Okay, so obviously they've already got the runs on the board, which makes sense. So partnering with a company like this, am I right in saying this just sort of breaks down the development process because you're not literally starting from ground level when you're designing this engine?
Yeah, I'd say that's correct.
All right, let's talk about the engine itself. What are the basic parameters of the engine and what was the intended sort of power level and RPM level?
So power-wise, we're going for around 720 horsepower at 12,000 RPM.
This is naturally aspirated, to be clear.
It's NA, yeah, with barrel throttles, so ITB's there. Yeah.
At engine capacity, can we get bore and stroke details?
Yeah, so it's a 4-litre, 72-degree V10, obviously, and it's 86 mm bore and a 68.8 stroke.
So we're almost getting on towards pushing 200 horsepower per litre out of it.
Yeah, yeah, I think it's like 185 per litre at the moment, yeah.
Now, if we look back at sort of performance road car engines, I remember when we sort of had that 100 horsepower per litre was the kind of benchmark. If you were a little bit north of that, you're doing pretty well. Getting to approach 200 horsepower per litre, if we look at a road car engine, is almost impossible without forced induction. What is it about a racing V10 like this with the ability to rev so high that makes 720 horsepower or close to 200 horsepower per litre a potential reality?
Well, I guess it's just the way like materials and stuff and the technology has just developed over time. And like we're going to be running around 110% volumetric efficiency, I think, whereas we're only at about 90 now. So there's still quite a lot of improvement there on our development engine.
So that 110% volumetric efficiency, in essence, what we're talking about there is how completely the engine's able to fill its cylinders with air. Now, that's a really key criteria. Obviously, the more air and realistically more oxygen we can get into the cylinder, the more fuel we can add, the bigger the bang, the more power. But the other key part that's really easy to overlook is that RPM multiplier. And if we're talking about horsepower, the equation is our torque multiplied by our engine RPM, then divided by a constant 5,252. So the key part there is the higher in the RPM we can make peak torque, we get that multiplier of RPM, and that's where that power can come from. Now, when you're designing an engine like this, there's a lot of literally moving parts to it. How much of this is currently being produced in-house at Rodin, and how much are you outworking?
So at the moment, we've machined crankshafts, camshafts, and for the sort of third development engine we're doing, we're still using the Pankel rods and pistons because we've still got a few sets there that we got from Neil Brown.
but you do intend to bring manufacturing of those parts in-house as well?
Yeah, so at the moment we're still like buying machines and stuff to do all that sort of manufacturing, but we will be manufacturing everything in-house.
On face value, again, it would seem like a sensible option to partner with someone like Pankel, who again, as we've said, they've got the runs on the board, they know what they're doing, rather than reinventing the wheel and making these parts. Can you give us some idea of like where the thought process is on making them in-house?
So again, it just comes back to that control. Like Pankel's dealing with a lot of high-level people, especially in F1 and stuff, and they're their focus, whereas we're just a little company in New Zealand and we want, say, 5 engines at a time. That doesn't really suit their efficiencies for the manufacturing side of things.
So it's really a scale thing. Yeah. They don't really want to deal with making only 5 sets of parts at a time.
Yeah, yeah. Like I think for the first 5 crankshafts, with an order of 5, was about €45,000 a piece.
Yeah, okay, that's going to make for a very expensive engine, and I won't put you on the spot and ask what the cost of one of these engines is going to be. In terms of some of the technologies that Rodin have in-house, in terms of 3D printing, casting, can you talk us through how you're leveraging those technologies for the manufacturing of this engine?
So 3D printing is something that we're really, really trying to be innovative on and stuff like that. So with the engine, we actually 3D print the buck of the engine, and we go about like an investment casting sort of style. So it gets dipped in a ceramic, the resin gets burned out, and then we use a vacuum casting technique to actually suck that molten aluminium into the void, then break away all the excess material, cut off the extra bits, and then put it in a CNC machine. So we're literally casting it from the raw ingots of aluminium.
Can you talk to us a little bit more about why using the vacuum casting process? I'm definitely not a casting specialist, but it sounds quite unique. What are the sort of benefits of that vacuum casting?
So it increases the density of the material and stops like porosity and voids and that sort of thing, because it is such a quick process. It's sitting there under vacuum with everything ready to go, and you open a valve and it just sucks it straight in.
That's sort of one of the potential problems with conventional casting, is sort of inclusions, porosities inside of the casting, which affect the sort of strength of the material, correct?
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay, so in terms of the sort of selection of the process between 3D printing and casting, how do you decide which parts, or actually for that matter, machining from billet, how do you decide which process is suitable for which component?
So the reason why we've gone casting for the sort of bigger main components like the cylinder head and the block and also various stages of the oil pump is just because if you're machining up to say like 30 billet blocks, that's going to be sort of efficient that way. But as soon as you get over those sort of numbers, casting really comes into play with like economies of scale side of things.
Okay, now we've talked about the aim for this in a naturally aspirated form, 720 horsepower. You're not quite there at this stage, but this is sort of a moving target. You're in development. What is holding it back at the moment, and sort of can you let us know what power level you've got to?
Yeah, so as you were saying, this is like our development. This is actually our first proper testing scenario here. So
it'll go well.
Yeah, it's been going really well so far. So we actually finished the car probably just a couple of weeks before it got put in the container and sent over here. So this is really our debut out on the track, testing how everything is. But I think we're around the mid 500 horsepower at the moment, but that's running a single throttle body and with some restrictions in the plenum.
And we were talking off camera before, this is really around packaging into the Sentura chassis that's driven the single throttle body and plenum. Really conventionally, this is going to be running a barrel throttle, individual throttle body. So there's a restriction there or a limitation there?
Yes, there definitely is. And so our engine was actually originally designed to be twin turboed, and that's what it was going to be. And then we had the idea, like, we can make an NA version. So that's also running the same port geometry as the turbo engine, the same cams and stuff. So as soon as we start playing with that sort of side of things, we can see gains there on the NA engine as well.
Now, you just mentioned twin turbo, so this engine is developed also for the upcoming Rodin F0, which I believe is still in development with power targets, I believe, well north of 1,000 horsepower.
Yeah.
And what changes are required internally with that engine to go from a 720 horsepower target to north of 1,000?
So with the NA engine, I think we're running around 15:1 compression. So obviously in the turbo configuration, that's going to drop substantially. Other than that, it's pretty much the same engine at the moment. So the development's more going to be on the NA side of things. So like you say, the barrel throttles, the cams, the port geometry, and possibly some changes to the compression ratio, because obviously at 15:1, we're limited to what sort of fuels we can run. So we're going to have to do testing with slightly lower compression so that we sort of open up that market to different fuels as well.
I'm interested as well just in terms of strength of the internal components, mainly around, let's say, the bore design. There's a few different ways of going about this. What has Rodin gone down the path of with the bore?
So we've got steel liners that are sort of pressed into the aluminium block, and they're Nikasil as well.
Okay, so the reasoning there, you can't run steel rings on a steel liner, correct?
Correct.
However, the steel is an incredibly strong liner material. Can you talk to us, for those who haven't heard about Nikasil, what exactly is that and how is that applied? How does it work?
I'm not too clued up on it myself, but I believe it's like a, it's almost like a metal spraying process that's then polished. Yeah.
Is that- this is quite common in current sort of motorcycle and even some road car technology where for manufacturing reasons or cost reasons, the bores are actually just the finished cast alloy, aluminium, and obviously we can't run rings on there either. No. So this Nikasil coating is then applied to give a hard wearing surface that the rings run on. So quite cost effective for the manufacturer, but in the aftermarket for us, a bit of a problem when it comes to freshening up the bores. In terms of fueling as well, I noticed that this is set up for direct injection, which for a road car engine is a no-brainer. That's the way everything's gone. But for a performance application, pros and cons there. I'm just interested why you went down that route.
So basically, it all comes down to what our founder David wanted. But I think he's quite interested in being, well, like with the front runners and any sort of new technology. That's where his passion lies. So he saw that opportunity, like, hey, people aren't really using DI for performance-based applications, and it's something that he wants to possibly develop in-house. Yeah.
Has that been something that you're leveraging existing road car componentry for the likes of the actual injectors themselves? I mean, obviously, that's not something that you're necessarily going to create from scratch. Same with the high-pressure fuel pumps.
Yeah. So we're going to Bosch there. So for the injectors and the fuel pumps, because they know what they're doing. Yeah.
That makes sense. Again, no reason to reinvent the wheel on every part. Look, Mike, it's been great to get some insight into this engine. Quite proud myself of this racing engine being developed in my own country. So we wish you all the best. If people do want to find out more about the engine or Rodin cars in general, how are they best to do so?
Just our website, www.rodincars.com.
Perfect. Thanks for your time.
Cheers.
That video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week, and if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.